Coastal lagoons are a dominant landscape feature in the Arctic coastline. Over one-third of the coastline between the Seward Peninsula and the Canadian border include coastal lagoons. These are some of the most productive habitats in the world. They function as a nursery for many animals, and they protect the inner shores from harsh ocean waves and storm surges. Though remote and difficult to access, biologists with the National Park Service and Wildlife Conservation Society are working together to better understand the ecology and dynamic environments of these lagoons under a changing climate and increasing human activity in the Arctic.
Arctic lagoon systems are unique for several reasons. Number one, they're some of the last naturally functioning lagoons in the world. Lagoons are, you know, coastal lagoons, like all coastal habitat, has been really impacted by humans just because there's a lot of human use in coastal regions across the world. And Arctic lagoons are unique in the sense that there isn't very much human impact to them yet, just because there's not a lot of humans in the Arctic. Another reason why Arctic lagoons are unique is that they're still used traditionally for subsistence hunting and fishing. That's a really important part of the culture of the Arctic. Lagoons are still relied heavily upon for that subsistence lifestyle. In order to get a nutritious meal, it costs a lot of money. And they have access to the food that has been sustaining their culture for thousands of years in these lagoons. Our lagoons project is focused on Cape Krusenstern National Monument and Bering Land Bridge National Preserve. Our focus is to look at the fish species in the lagoons and document what species are there at what times and sort of understand how the fish community changes through time and how they're using the lagoons. We're also very interested in trying to understand how these fish species fit into the subsistence lifestyle. In other words, we've been working with people out of the village of Kotzebue, and they're harvesting fish at certain times of the year. Where are those fish moving from place to place? So a lot of this stuff is undocumented, and we're just doing the first few steps in terms of trying to figure out how are these fish important for these different subsistence communities, and when are they important? How many fish are they catching? How are the fish populations changing through time? And is that going to affect subsistence fishing in the future? The lagoons that we're studying, especially the ones in Cape Krusenstern, are very dynamic. We're finding that these lagoons are so highly dynamic that just one season is certainly not enough. And two seasons, we're seeing so much change even within the season and between seasons that, you know, it's going to be really interesting to see how this compares to some of the historic data. So there's just a ton of variation. Another instance of this was a small lagoon called Tasechek Lagoon up the coast from here. We sampled that for the first time this year. The first time we went there, we put out a gill net, and as we're putting it out, there's whitefish hitting the gill net to the point where we actually, as soon as we put it out, we had to pull the net because we already were catching way too many fish to deal with. This last time we put it out, this is probably less than a month later, we left it out for 2 hours and caught two fish. So definite strong within season variation and strong between season variation. These dynamics really shape the fish communities. The cool thing about this research is that we're still discovering new species in these lagoons that have never been documented in these particular lagoons before. So that kind of gives you the idea of how baseline we are. For instance, in the lagoons we studied last summer, I think we found over 30 species that were new to a particular lagoon. We're starting to understand the trophic dynamics of these lagoons. In other words, what fish are eating and how that fits into the whole lagoon food web. So mysids are really essential.
So these are sculpin. And this one's a nine-spine stickleback, and that's a mysid. So these guys will eat that.
And you can go to a lagoon and look from the shoreline, just look at the bottom of the lagoon and see thousands of mysids just streaming by. And so you can imagine why fish are entering these lagoons when they have all this amazing food to eat. Another important species that we're finding are nine-spine stickleback, and they're just showing up in huge abundances. We can put out a fike net and capture 10,000 nine-spine stickleback in a few hours. And those stickleback are eating mysids. And then with regards to apex predators, shefish, which are another really important white fish subsistence species, are moving into lagoons and eating all the stickleback. So you can start seeing how the food web is starting to be built. Mysids, stickleback, shefish, and then we're filling in all the levels in between that too.
It gives us a good sort of project to work on in the winter, is trying to put all this stuff that we're finding in context and see, you know, how this stuff really plays out in terms of the dynamics of the lagoons.